Good. First of all, let me apologize for the delay, but it has been a very intense, very positive, constructive morning of work with our ministerial meeting of the Union for the Mediterranean here in Barcelona. Let me start by saying that it has been and it is an honor for me to co-chair this annual gathering of foreign ministers in the Union for the Mediterranean with the new Jordanian minister of Foreign Affairs, Ayman SAFADI. We already became friends, and I am sure that we will continue to work together, not only bilaterally, but also as co-chairs of the Union for the Mediterranean, as the European Union and Jordan have been doing in these last years. I want also to take this opportunity to salute and thank his predecessor, Mr. Nasser Judeh, with whom we've worked in an excellent manner all over these years. But as I said, we have already started an excellent cooperation with Ayman. Since 2012, the economic regional cooperation has been the core business of the Union for the Mediterranean. This means working with concrete projects on education, job creation, and economic sustainable development. And we have delivered already concrete results, direct benefits for the young people, women, entrepreneurs, and citizens in our region. I am sure the Secretary General will be more detailed in presenting the results of this work, but let me tell you just that having 43 countries, overall population of 800 million people in our region gives us a size, a magnitude, an impact that is quite unique. And the 47, if I'm not wrong, regional projects labeled 5.5 billion euros supporting this is really a very concrete outcome of hard work, not only of the Secretariat, but also of our teams. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank all the teams that have been working also for this ministerial that has brought, I think, big and important results. I will close with this by saying that in terms of political results of this meeting today, I believe we have made a very important commitment, collective commitment today with all the ministers and the representatives around the table. It is more and more evident in our region that the way to solve conflicts, manage crises, prevent tensions, is more regional integration and more regional cooperation. This is the most conflictual region of the world, and it's also the less integrated one. The two things have a connection, and the European history has shown us over decades, if not over centuries, that the less integration, the less cooperation you have at regional level, the more conflicts you are likely to have, and on the other side, the more conflicts and tensions you have, the more difficult cooperation and integration becomes. So today we have committed together to break this circle of lack of integration and tensions and conflictuality and invest in a coherent manner on more political dialogue and more regional integration and cooperation on very concrete fields of action through our Union for the Mediterranean. This is going to have an impact on our citizens' lives, and the special focus of our deliberations today has been the focus on youth, because we know well not only the demographic trends of our region indicates that this is the smart thing to do for our present and not only for our future, but also tackling the issue of giving adequate space to our youth, both in Europe and in the rest of the Mediterranean region, is also key to a certain number of top priorities that we share. The economic development, guaranteeing that our societies are open societies with a space for each and every citizen, the management of migration flows, but also the prevention of radicalization and the management of our security concerns that we also share. So our decision today is this, to sum up in short, and I stop here, increase our political cooperation, increase our common work on concrete projects for regional integration and cooperation with a special focus on youth, and try to use this to create more stability and more peace in the region. I would like to thank all my friends here on stage with me, and in particular, last word, the Spanish government, my friend, the foreign minister, Alfonso, for having welcomed us, as always, in an excellent manner in Spain. Gracias. And I'll give the floor to my co-chair, the Jordanian foreign
minister. Thank you so much. Let me please start by thanking you, Madame Mogherini, for your kind words, for your friendship. I've just started my service, as you all know, and I've already been overwhelmed by the kind of kindness and support that you've shown me. I cannot thank you enough for that, and I look forward to working with you and with the rest of our colleagues on serving our common interests. I could not have had a better start, so thank you so much for that. Our relations with the EU, as you know, are solid. They are rooted in our common belief in the need to work together and spreading our common values of peace, and stability, and justice, and ending conflicts in the region. That is something that is extremely dear. Those relations are extremely dear to His Majesty the King, who has repeatedly stressed our need to work together to build on our bilateral relations and to work together on facing the many, many challenges that we face jointly. I would like to also thank His Excellency, the Foreign Minister of Spain, for again, for your friendship, for hosting us, and for allowing us to meet in this beautiful city of Barcelona. So again, I thank you, and through you, I thank the Kingdom of Spain for that. I have to say a word of recognition to the SG and his team at the Secretariat. I think it is your work that brought us here to today with the rest of your colleagues. You've done an extremely wonderful job, sir. I thank you on behalf of everybody and on behalf of the Jordanian team to this conference. So thank you so much for a job extremely well done. Madame Mogherini spoke for both of us when she stressed the interconnectedness of our futures. I cannot stress enough the fact that we are interconnected, our security is interconnected, our prosperity is interconnected. The challenges we face are enormous. We want to work together, and we can work together, and only through working together will we be able to stand up to the forces of evil that threaten all of our securities. Together we are in a fight against a group of terrorists who do not belong to our common humanity, who certainly do not represent any religion, and certainly not our great Islamic faith and its values of peace and acceptance and respect for the other. Our fight against this common enemy is one. We fight them on the military field, but we also fight them culturally by standing up to their distorted narrative and by also creating hope to our people and to our youth. Particularly relevant to this is the fact that this union today, our forum focused on youth, they are the future. We need to give them opportunity. We need to give them political horizon and economic horizon. Only if we are able to address their legitimate needs and concerns for dignified life in countries and in places that are politically inclusive will we be able to stand up to the dark appeal of terrorism. The areas for us to cooperation are numerous. I look forward to working with all our colleagues in the Mediterranean to address those challenges. As I said, the Med is not a body of water that separates us. It's a bridge that has historically brought us together and will continue to bring us together towards serving our common interest of, again, peace, justice, prosperity, and stability for all. Thank you so much.
Gracias a los dos copresidentes de la Unión para el Mediterráneo. Gracias al secretario general por su excelente trabajo. Como saben ustedes, esta es la segunda reunión de ministros de Exteriores después de la de 2015 y muestra el compromiso de los líderes de ambas orillas del Mediterráneo por tratar de responder juntos a los desafíos que nos aquejan y que tienen que ver con la estabilidad, con la prosperidad de esta región. La Unión para el Mediterráneo es un foro privilegiado de diálogo y vamos a intentar desarrollar ese diálogo en los próximos años poniendo el énfasis en los proyectos concretos, desarrollar la Unión para el Mediterráneo como un foro de diálogo, una plataforma de cooperación y un promotor de programas concretos para apoyar a nuestros países, como digo, para hacer frente a los desafíos comunes. Ha sido para mí un honor haber dado lugar a que se celebre esta reunión. Quiero aprovechar la oportunidad para dar gracias a la ciudad de Barcelona y a la Generalitat por su hospitalidad y su generosidad. No voy a entrar en los detalles de la reunión. Creo que el secretario general puede desarrollar tanto la hoja de ruta que acabamos de aprobar como el foro en particular, que hoy se centra en la juventud, pero en el futuro se centrará en otros programas concretos, como digo, con ese objetivo compartido. Quiero, sin embargo, también mencionar que, con arreglo a esa naturaleza de foro de diálogo, también en el almuerzo que vamos a celebrar a continuación, tendremos la oportunidad de abordar otras cuestiones políticas que, si no son objeto del foro formalmente, sí nos permitirá intercambiar opiniones para hacer un balance de cómo abordamos los desafíos de la región. Sin más, le doy la palabra al secretario general, a quien le agradezco de nuevo su excelente trabajo.
Thank you very much, and my great appreciation and gratitude to the co-presidency for their leadership, for their commitment and the support to the UfM secretariat activity and the overall UfM activities. Thank you also, of course, to Spain for its leadership, for its very strong and active involvement, and for hosting our organization and for the political support also it is providing to our work. This morning's meeting of the Ministers of Foreign Affairs under the co-chairmanship of the UfM presidency gave a clear new political momentum for the UfM. The roadmap that ministers have adopted gives to the UfM a clear political guidance to work under the framework of the four pillars of action. First one is enhancing the political dialogue among the member states. The second is to ensure the contribution of UfM activities to regional stability and human development, as you rightly pointed out. The third is strengthening regional integration, which is an essential objective. And the fourth is to consolidate the UfM capacity for action. I'd also like to mention that ministers have decided in the roadmap to hold the UfM Regional Forum on an annual basis in Barcelona. This political momentum is important because it will enable us to amplify the impact of the progress and the achievements we have reached until today and to strengthen the contribution of the UfM to addressing current challenges in the region. With 47 labeled projects, 10 ministerial meetings, over 200 expert forums, gathering 20,000 stakeholders, UfM activities illustrate our strong belief that regional challenges call for regional solutions and that there is no security without development. And in this regard, youth is at the heart of the Mediterranean agenda. Let me illustrate this. I would like here to mention two recently launched projects. The UfM labeled projects for the depollution of the Lake Bizerte in Tunisia, launched by the head of the government of Tunisia, in your presence, High Representative Mr. Mogherini, with the Jordanian co-presidency and your humble servant. This project, co-financed by the EIB, EBRD, European Commission and the Tunisian government, opens new perspectives for growth and development for a region of over 500,000 inhabitants in the north of Tunisia. The second project I would like to mention is the launch in the framework of the COP22 last November in Marrakesh of the project called SPREF, developed with EBRD, which will allow to mobilize around 900 million euros, 900 million euros for the development of private investment in renewable energy in four countries in the southern Mediterranean. Let me also announce the following four outcomes of this second edition of the UfM Regional Forum, because, as the co-president says, we are here to be action-oriented and we are an action-driven organization. First, the launching tomorrow of the UfM label project Génération Entrepreneur, an entrepreneurship project which illustrates the role played by the private sector in responding to the challenges of youth employment and job creation in the region, reaching to 80,000 young people in the region. Second, I am very pleased to announce that the UfM Secretariat has concluded today a multi-annual financing agreement with the Swedish International Development Cooperation Agency to implement and strengthen the UfM core activity. Third, a cooperation agreement will be signed tomorrow with the United Nations Office for South-South Cooperation, and another one with the institution managing the Agadir Agreement. The Agadir Agreement is a free trade agreement between four countries, Morocco, Tunisia, Egypt, and Jordan. These two partnerships aim at reinforcing the strategic objective of regional integration. Fourth, and perhaps most importantly, I am very happy that a large number of young beneficiaries of UfM-labeled projects are among us at this forum. This is an important outcome for all of us. We are happy to have them with us and to see the impact of UfM-supported activities developing on the ground. This highlights the identity of the UfM to be an action-oriented organization. With the momentum provided in this regional forum, we are determined to amplify further our action and to mobilize all efforts in order to address effectively and concretely the root causes of the current pressing challenges in the Mediterranean. And thank you for your attention.
Gracias. La gestión de la página web de la Casa Blanca es una cuestión de la Casa Blanca, es una cuestión interna de los Estados Unidos. Nosotros, evidentemente, lamentamos que se haya suprimido la versión española de esa página web. No nos parece una buena idea. Creemos que, siendo un país en el que hay 52 millones de personas que hablan el castellano o el español, no es una gran idea renunciar a un instrumento de comunicación. Nosotros, como lo hemos mostrado hoy aquí en Barcelona y en la Unión para el Mediterráneo, somos partidarios del diálogo, y cuantos más medios o instrumentos haya de desarrollar ese diálogo, mejor nos parece.
Sí. De que los españoles que pertenecen al Estado Islámico, que están en Siria o en Irak, están presionando para que se rente en España, y que hay bastante miedo con el tema de los lobos solitarios que podrían afectar aquí en España. Se calcula que hay como unos 100, no sé si tienen constancia de esto, y si se ha hablado también de este tema de seguridad a nivel europeo, el tema de ISIS.
Sí, el tema de ISIS y la seguridad a nivel europeo lo hablamos constantemente. En cuanto a esa información que he leído esta mañana, no tengo constancia, pero entra dentro de lo previsible. Y confirmo que efectivamente la cuestión de los lobos solitarios forma parte de los elementos, de los temas que abordamos, como digo, en esa conversación continua que tenemos a todos los niveles en la Unión Europea.
Sí,
eso ya son malos. Creo que han sido ya tres, no dos, pero en fin, trataré de responder brevemente a las tres. Mi conversación con el presidente Puigdemont ha sido una conversación amistosa, agradable, era la primera vez que nos encontrábamos. Hemos hablado de los temas objeto de esta reunión, de la Unión para el Mediterráneo. Yo he tenido, como ya he dicho antes, ocasión de agradecerle su hospitalidad y hemos hablado un poco también de como he dicho, de los temas de esta reunión, de la juventud, de la inmigración, etc. En cuanto al acto de mañana, como usted sabe, en Europa se defiende la libertad de expresión, es perfectamente legítimo que cada uno defienda su visión política. Por nuestra parte, nosotros en Europa seguiremos defendiendo con arreglo a lo que establecen los tratados nuestra visión del Estado de Derecho y de la democracia, con arreglo a la idea de una España abierta, plural e integradora. Y respecto al CIDOB, aún no se ha tomado ninguna determinación, pero es de todos conocido el malestar del Ministerio por que se hayan tomado determinadas decisiones sobre el patronato, en que creíamos que con arreglo a esa visión de diálogo y de integración, que debía haber sido tomado en cuenta o al menos consultado en el Ministerio. Gracias.
Peut-être, puisque apparemment la question m'était destinée, je voudrais commencer par dire que effectivement, la feuille de route qui a été adoptée aujourd'hui, elle a été adoptée par les 43 membres de l'Union pour la Méditerranée, et donc elle nous engage tous collectivement. J'ajoute que c'est un processus, c'est une dynamique, et qui vise à renforcer et amplifier le mouvement qui a été enclenché et qui permettra de pouvoir opérationnaliser davantage l'ambition commune. Mais je crois que ce qui est plus important encore à relever ici, c'est de savoir que nous sommes dans une logique d'opérationnalisation des ambitions. Car je crois que la région euro-méditerranéenne n'a pas besoin d'encore des discours, n'a pas besoin d'idées théoriques. Nous avons en face de nous une jeunesse qui réclame des réponses concrètes, qui réclame des réponses précises. C'est la raison pour laquelle, lorsque nous disons que nous travaillons sur des projets et des projets régionaux, nous le faisons pour les deux raisons suivantes. La première, c'est le caractère régional de nos actions, parce que nous croyons en l'importance de l'intégration régionale, nous croyons en l'importance de la coopération régionale. Il n'y a pas un défi sécuritaire, économique ou autre qui ne puisse être traité à l'échelon d'un seul pays. Et par définition, engage Donc la première conviction est la conviction du caractère régional. La deuxième, c'est que les projets sont la partie visible de l'expression de la volonté politique. Et donc il n'y a aucune déconnexion entre le niveau politique et le niveau des projets. Et permettez-moi simplement de revenir sous le contrôle de mon collègue secrétaire d'État tunisien ici présent, simplement sur l'exemple du projet de Bizerte. Car c'est un projet de dépollution du lac de Bizerte. Par ailleurs, je vous invite tous à aller visiter cette région magnifique de la Tunisie. C'est un lac absolument extraordinaire où on peut facilement imaginer les développements de toutes les activités touristiques, économiques et autres. Mais au-delà du caractère environnemental, entre guillemets, du travail qui doit être fait et qui est important et qui a été initié, c'est des perspectives de création d'emplois et de développement économique à plus de 500 000 personnes dans cette région qui est au nord de la Tunisie, donc au nord de l'Afrique, aux portes de l'Europe. Et donc nous traitons à travers cela des thématiques de la jeunesse, des thématiques de la création d'emplois, des thématiques de la croissance, mais également des thématiques de la lutte contre l'immigration, de la thématique de la sécurité et de la thématique de la stabilisation et de le plein potentiel offert aux populations concernées. Et ce projet-là a été fait parce qu'il est d'abord dans la priorité du gouvernement tunisien, avec le soutien des institutions financières internationales, et donc c'est aussi la capacité de l'UPM de coordonner les instruments financiers. Je salue la présence parmi nous du vice-président de la BEI, qui est le principal financeur aux côtés de la Commission européenne. Je salue également la présence de Michael Keller avec nous ici, qui a financé également le projet, et de la Banque européenne de reconstruction et de développement. Donc c'est la capacité de pouvoir rassembler les institutions financières internationales, de pouvoir déterminer une priorité pour un pays et de pouvoir inscrire le tout dans un cadre régional, car c'est une action qui s'inscrit dans le programme régional méditerranéen Horizon 2020. Et donc c'est là où le triangle se complète entre la dimension régionale, la dimension opérationnelle et la dimension financière. Et c'est cela qui fait la spécificité, la valeur ajoutée et la force de l'UPM aujourd'hui. Et nous nous engageons à travers la feuille de route à l'amplifier davantage encore. Merci.
Si je peux ajouter une petite chose pour être très concrète. Déjà, l'Union pour la Méditerranée, ensemble, ça veut dire nous ensemble, les 43, avec le soutien du secrétariat, le travail du secrétariat, par exemple, sur le côté de l'emploi des jeunes, on est arrivé à avoir 26 projets avec un impact sur 200 000 jeunes dans la région. C'est quelque chose de très concret. L'exemple de Lac Bizerte, c'est seulement un des exemples des projets qui touchent soit sur l'emploi, mais aussi sur la gestion de la pollution, sur le climat, l'énergie, comment dire en français, renewable energy, le transport, la gestion des espaces et de développement urbain. Et ça veut dire que ça touche vraiment la vie des gens. Et si je peux ajouter une chose, on voit toujours la nécessité de créer des liens entre les deux côtés de la Méditerranée. Mais en effet, si on regarde par exemple le commerce dans la région, on se rend compte que 90% de ce commerce a lieu à l'intérieur de l'Union européenne, 9% entre l'Union européenne et le reste de la région, et seulement 1% de commerce sur les côtés sud, c'est-à-dire à l'intérieur de la même côté de la Méditerranée. Et c'est pour ça que l'intégration régionale est tellement importante pour le développement économique, pour le développement social, mais aussi pour la sécurité, parce que la coopération économique est aussi une forte, très forte base pour la coopération sur les côtés de la paix et de la sécurité.
Hello, I have a question for Mogherini. I would like your opinion on Donald Trump's inaugural address last Friday. It seems to be a policy about America first, seems to be quite confrontational. And is the European Union ready to define him or policies that are in our common ground between Brussels and Washington, like climate change, Russia, refugees?
it's some 20 questions in one.
Exactly.
I'll try. But I'll try. First of all, the European Union is more than ready, willing to cooperate with the new US administration on the basis of our own policies, our own priorities, our own values. So I can say, I don't know if this is Europe first, but for sure I see a lot of fields where American and European interests coincide. And we will define with the new administration once all the teams are settled in their respective ministries, their set of priorities and policies. Some of them are still in definition and in the making, this is normal. Our policies and priorities, and see where we have coinciding policies, coinciding interests, where we have space for intense cooperation. I'm convinced that especially on counterterrorism, security, but also on some of the conflicts we have in the region, in the Mediterranean, we will have a common interest to cooperate as well as we have cooperated always with the last US administration. There will be issues where probably our interests or our positions will not coincide, but it is not for me to spell out the US policies before the new administration will. The EU positions are clear and well known on many different issues, including on the Israelo-Palestinian conflict. By the way, this morning I had the chance of meeting here with both the Israeli Minister for Regional Cooperation and the Palestinian Foreign Minister. And we discussed not only bilateral issues, but also the EU support to the restart of direct negotiations. I've seen that this is also the affirmed position of the Trump administration, a support to direct talks between the parties. This is exactly the position the European Union has always had. So we will see for actions, and it is not up to us to determine the direction that these actions or these policies will take. But for sure, the European positions are clear, and we will work with the US administration on the basis of our own positions that are determined, as you know, in Brussels or elsewhere we meet at 28. I would just like to say that, again, especially on the Israel-Palestinian issue, the European Union approach is that of trying to help the parties to find common ground to achieve the two-state solution. This is our aim, and we will continue to work, hopefully, with our partners in the quartet, US, Russia, and the United Nations, with our Arab partners, Jordan, Egypt, other countries, Arab League, on the basis of the Arab Peace Initiative that for us is a very good basis to start with. And first and foremost with the parties. We have strong ties both with Israel and with Palestine. And this is a plus that the European Union puts at the service of the international community to try and facilitate a positive solution to the conflict. Because when we talk about the need to focus on the youth or on the economic cooperation in the region, this also includes Israel and Palestine. And we see the need, especially when sharing such a small portion of land, to have cooperation based on steps on the ground that can make life easier for the people on all sides.
Thank you. Jordan and the United States have traditionally, historically, enjoyed very strong and friendly relations. We definitely value that relationship, and we are looking forward to working with the new U.S. administration on addressing the common challenges and serving the common interests that we have. Certainly of these, there's enough. We all face the challenge of terrorism. We all face the challenge of conflict resolution. We have the interest of promoting democracy, promoting stability, promoting prosperity. So we will be looking forward to working with the U.S. administration on that. And as friends and as allies, we will definitely do what friends expect from friends, which is to speak very openly and very truthfully on what we feel should be done in order to further our common interest of peace and stability and conflict resolution in the region. On the Palestinian issue, Jordan has been a voice for peace and a voice for reason. Historically, it will continue to do so. We believe that the only way to achieve lasting peace and stability in the whole region is to solve this key root of all conflicts on the basis, again, of the two-state solution, which the whole world has accepted as the only way forward. That solution would deliver freedom and statehood to the Palestinians and would guarantee security and acceptance to the Israelis. The High Representative spoke of the Arab Peace Initiative. That is something that we remain committed to. We believe it's the best comprehensive offer that has ever been put to bring about comprehensive peace. As you know, Jordan will be hosting the Arab Summit very, very soon, and it is our hope that we will be able to once again reiterate that unwavering commitment to peace on the basis of the Arab Peace Initiative, and again, on the two-state solution. I have to warn that we all in the international community fear that the viability of the two-state solution is being compromised by unilateral actions that are making that solution untenable. As such, we need to stop all unilateral actions that threaten the status quo, that threaten the identity of Jerusalem, that threaten the Christian-Muslim heritage of the Holy City, and work together on launching effective talks that will bring about this lasting peace that is a right to every Arab, Palestinian, Muslim, Christian, Jew in that part of the world. We can no longer afford to have this impasse in peace talks. Let me just say that the peace process has been frozen for a long time. The absence of political horizon is creating conditions of despair and anger, which is the fertile ground for radical and hard ideologies to come and abuse and prey on. We're sure that we'd be able to have this very honest and very frank conversation with our American partners and friends, and we know we can always count on the support and on the understanding of our European partners and friends. We see eye to eye on the need to move very quickly and very systematically on this front. Again, a process has been absent for long. We need to restart the process, but this time around, in order not to lose further hope and in order not to allow for further despair to dig roots, we have to have a process that's very clearly targeted towards very clear objectives and timelines so that we can move forward. Another issue is the issue of refugees that you touched on. I have to say that we are at capacity in Jordan as far as attending to the needs of Syrian refugees. We have about 20% of our population now are out of Syrian refugees. Our schools are overcrowded. Our hospital services are overwhelmed. We cannot do it alone anymore. We have to get the support of the international community, help us meet those not just humanitarian but also developmental needs of refugees. I have to say, Jordan, as His Majesty said before, we are shouldering this burden on behalf of the international community. The international community need to come and help. Not as a favor to Jordan, I must say, even though we do appreciate the tremendous support we got from our partners, but it's an investment in our collective security. We have hundreds of thousands of young Syrians who are now, not just in Jordan, but in other host countries. We have two choices. Let them grow up abandoned, desperate, miserable, with no education, with no investment, and let them feel betrayed by the whole world. And if that is the case, then we're talking about a lost generation that would be probably the best gift that we can give to Daesh and the likes of Daesh in the future, or work collectively on investing those people, providing them with education, providing them with training, and they will be the Syrian generation that will go back to their country and engage in the reconstruction process that I know our European partners are working on, once a political process that is conducive to a solution that would be acceptable by the whole Syrian people is done. So the challenges are numerous, but also are the opportunities. I'd like to look at the positive side of things, and we say we have an opportunity now to start afresh, us in the region, Jordan, our Arab brethren, countries and friends, our European partners, and our American friends, and work together collectively on serving our common interest of bringing peace, justice, stability, and prosperity to the region.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you.